next problem.
All right. It's a pleasure to welcome our speaker today. I've spoke here several times before, Kathleen Pfaff from University of California, Santa Barbara, and she's going to tell us something about strata of geodesics and outer space, right?
Oh, you remember the title better than me. Yes. Okay. So thank you very much. So the reason for all this, so the outline is we'll actually talk about or tell you what the outer automorphism group of the free group is, and then I'll give you inspiration from above and afar, and then we'll talk about traveling in outer space, and then we'll talk about invariance in traveling in outer space. So to start out, so we're going to fix, so FR is going to be the rank of free group, and in general, these will be my generators. And then the outer automorphism group of the free group, I'm going to take automorphisms of the free group, and then I'm going to quotient out by inner automorphisms. And to be nice, I'm going to tell you what those are. So for each element of the free group, we get an inner automorphism. So for A, and what it does is it conjugates everything by A. So this is for all A and B in the free group. But I don't picture it that way. I picture it as a picture. So I'm going to take a rose. Let's do this in a way that makes this work nicely. And I'm going to stick the generators on the petals. And then, for example, if I wanted to look at the automorphism, which sends, let's send x1 to x1, we'll send x2 to x3, and then we will send x3 to x2 and x3 inverse. So then what I would do is I would just let this dictate where I send the petals. So this loop would go over this loop because x1 goes to x1. And then the x2 loop goes over the x3 loop because that's what I said it was going to do. And then the x3 loop, it went over the x2 loop. Oops, sorry. The x3 loop went over the x2 loop and then the x3 loop backwards. And what I've managed to do, right, is to have this have the correct induced map of fundamental groups. And that picture will come back to haunt you. So that's the outer automorphism group of the free group. So now we're into inspiration from above. And for me, above would be higher dimensions, so the mapping class group. So S, let's just say it's a closed surface to make the definition easier. So then the mapping class group I can decide how many pluses I want to stick around and so on, but for a moment we'll just say it's orientation preserving homeomorphisms, and then for simplicity's sake, I'm going to mod out by homotopy. Okay, so, and then the connection that we have, and I gave you the wrong definition because I wanted it to be simple, so it doesn't actually fit into this. So now we want to take the mapping class group. And now I want to allow orientation reversing, and I want to take the once punctured torus, and this is going to be isomorphic to out pi 1 of the once punctured torus, which will be isomorphic to out f2. And in higher ranks, you still get a certain number of automorphisms coming from the mapping class group. So mapping class groups come in several flavors, or mapping classes, sorry. So we have finite order. Okay, I can't resist drawing for you a skewered alien telephone dial. There's something finite order. I can twist it once, and then if I do it three times, you go back. So it's finite order. And then reducible, some power is going to leave invariant some simple closed curve or subsurface bounded by the simple closed curve, essential simple closed curve. I'm most interested in pseudo-Nosovs. So they're going to leave invariant, and then I'll draw the picture for you. A pair of transverse singular minimal, I have all the words I want, minimal measured foliations. There, you could also just think of them as the ones that no power leaves invariant and essential simple closed curve, but I want this definition because I want to draw the correct pictures for you. So in most places, we want to think of these as just the level sets of x, y coordinates, right? So for x equals k or y equals l, okay? And then there are a few points where we've gotten greedy and we've stuck together maybe three half planes here. So let's give her. Or maybe in this circumstance, I'm going to emphasize where the prongs are there. And then over here, so we could have maybe I've stuck together five half planes. Okay, so the reason I want to draw it like this, so first off, what I'm actually doing when I'm leaving them invariant is I'm expanding along one and contracting along the other. But what I wanted to draw this picture and to talk about this way is because I want to tell you about what two invariants are now, because I'm not actually going to define them in the outer automorphism case. So you're just going to picture this. So here are my invariants. So the first one would be the index list. And in this case, these are actually the exact same invariant. So you'll see why in a moment. Because if I count through here, so I count one, I'm going to count the number of prongs, and then I'm going to write 1 minus 3 over 2, because 3 was the number of prongs, and I get minus 1 half. And then over here, I count the number of prongs again, so 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, so I get 1 minus 5 over 2, so I get minus 3 halves. So my index list is just going to be minus 1 half minus 3 halves. And now I have an exactly analogous, it's exactly the same invariant, which is going to be the Ida-Whitehead graph. And why is it exactly the same? So I'm just going to take this number 3, and I'm going to draw the polygon with that many vertices. So I take this number 5. And I draw the polygon with that number of vertices. So my ideal Whitehead graph over here is going to be the union. So I get a one component for each singularity with that number of vertices. And what this is recording is, so if I take any curve in my surface and I iterate it again and again and again, so I apply the pseudo-Nosov. So there's a pseudo-Nosov here. And I'm applying the pseudo-Nosov again and again and again. This approaches the lamination, and I want to record what the lamination does at the singularities. Okay, so it's not going to cross over the singularity, it's not going to cross over the prongs, but I want to see how it kind of hugs along the prongs. And then, if you kind of look at how I do that, that should look a lot like our triangle, right? And then here also I'm interested in how, why don't I do the same color prongs, so it's going to go along here. This is the lamination I got by iterating a curve, and again, if I kind of squeeze those together, I would get my pentagon. So what this is recording is the behavior of the lamination at the singularities, or what happens is I iterate a curve again and again and again at the singularities. So the mapping class group of a surface acts on the Teichmuller space for that surface. So what do we have? So the Teichmuller space of the surface, so you might, these are, well, so it's metrics on the surface with some added structure. Or a ball. But here, this is what this is. So I'm going to take my surface S, and I'm going to keep this surface in my hand. So in my hand is going to be down here. And I want to do this, so I'm keeping track of certain structures. So then the Teichmuller space, so here's my Teichmuller space. And what I have, so a point in Teichmuller space comes with two pieces of data. The first one being, so I have this little surface up here too, and on the surface I have a complete finite area hyperbolic metric. And then I have a diffeomorphism, and I can choose which way to do this. So I have a diffeomorphism, which we call a marking, down to the surface in hand. So I'm keeping track of some additional structures, such as how the fundamental group sits inside of that. Okay, so these are the, so the mapping class group is going to act on Teichmuller spaces and metrics on the surface. And I want to talk for a moment about the geodesics. This would be with the Teichmuller metric. There's only one metric. So what we're going to do is we're going to take, so you're going to have a picture similar to that over there in terms of you're going to have a pair of, so you're going to expand and contract a pair of transverse singular measured foliations from a quadratic differential. Okay, so this is a lot of words and I want to explain briefly, which is that, so the unit cotangent bundle, the Teichmuller space, so you could think the unit tangent bundle would be, would consist of quadratic differentials, and these are going to give us a pair of transverse singular measured foliations, kind of like that picture over there, and then you're going to slowly expand and contract them, and that's going to give you a geodesic. Now, you might think, because we had a picture of a pair of transverse measured singular foliations over there, that pseudo-Nosovs do give you geodesics by slowly expanding and contracting that same pair of foliations. Okay, so here are some important information to know, according to me. So the first thing I would say is that index lists are invariant under the geodesic flow. Which makes sense, right? Because if I'm just expanding and contracting the foliations, right, the index structure stays the same. These are actually being left invariant. The next thing that is important is that, so the principal stratum so this is where all of my prongs are three prongs. So the principal stratum is open in the space of quadratic differentials on the surface. So this ends up being important for a lot of reasons. So for example, if you want to talk about the ergodicity of the geodesic flow, it also was used improving what's generic within the mapping class group. So this is important for a variety of reasons, and it's something that later on we're going to come back to, as in this is our motivation for what we're doing in outer space, afar. So here's my inspiration from afar, which is just that the outer automorphism group of the free group is going to act on Culler-Vogtmann outer space. So what this is, so I can say first the key words. which are that the points are going to be marked metric graphs. So now, instead of having a surface that we keep in our hand to keep track of what's happening with the fundamental group, et cetera, instead I'm going to keep a rose where I stuck my generators on the pedals in my hand, and then, so this would be a graph, I'm going to assume. So the graph here means the valence of each vertex is at least 3. This is going to be a homotopy equivalence, which we're going to call the marking. And so that the picture that I drew over there makes sense, I want to explain it in this way. You could just imagine it being an identification of the fundamental group of the free group, but I want to explain this. So if I send this loop over this loop, then I'm going to call this x1. If I send this loop over this loop, I'm going to call this x2. And if I send this loop over this loop, I'm going to call this x3. Okay, so far, this is the marking. So they're marked metric graphs. The valence of each vertex is at least 3. Of course, it's going to have the correct fundamental group for this to be a homotopy equivalence. So I have one of these for each rank. The marking was this identification like this. And then the last thing is that I want to stick lengths on my edges and hope that they add up to 1. And I didn't plan ahead with that, so we'll see how well I do. How'd I do? Yes, they add up to 1. Okay. You can, anyway. And then we want to mod out by, so we want to, your chalk squeaks. We have these marked graphs. I want to have an isometry here so that this commutes rel homotopy. And then I cheated and drew this ahead of time to make it hard for you if you're taking notes. So what we want to do, so we're going to have an ideal simplicial structure. And why we get an ideal simplicial structure, so remember the points are marked metric graphs. So in rank 2, the graphs that you get are just these 3 graphs. So we're going to get a simplex or open simplex for each of these. So that's just why you're seeing me drawing those graphs all over the place. And we have them for each marking. So these are actually different markings. I would have different ones for other markings, which is why I wanted to show you where we just stick the generators on the loops like that. And then how do we move around? So why do we get a simplex first off? Because I assume that the lengths of the edges added to 1. So if my coordinates come from my lengths of my edges and they add to 1, that gives me a simplex. So this is why we have simplices. And then you can imagine, how do we move around? If I had this, so imagine there's a line in there, so this is a theta graph, and I make that length in the middle go to 0, I get a rose, and that's what I've done here. I made this length go to 0, I get a rose. I make this length go to 0, I get a rose. I make this length go to 0, I get a rose. So this is how they all kind of fit together. It's an ideal simplicial structure because if I make this length go to 0, right, I started with eyeglasses again, you have to use your imagination, and then I go tuck, 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 I get a lollipop, and a lollipop doesn't live, it doesn't have the correct rank, so it doesn't live in this outer space. So that's outer space. And then I want to talk about, geodesics in outer space, so for this, I need to first tell you about our version of a pseudo-Nosov. Do I end at 50 past? Is that okay? So we're going to say that phi in out FR is fully irreducible. No phi to the k, where k is greater than 0. So no positive power leaves invariant the conjugacy class of a proper 3 factor. Right, so free factor would mean that I could write fr as some kind of f like that. But you can also just think of these free factors. You don't want to be leaving these invariant, just like you don't want to leave invariant an essential simple closed curve or the essential subsurface. Those would leave some part of the fundamental group invariant, and that's what you don't want. So I want to give myself a brand new chalkboard and take my chalk with me. So I want to get, just like I got geodesics from pseudo-anosovs, I want to get geodesics from fully irreducibles. So I'd start out by fully irreducibles. So Maud and Vestina and Michael Handel proved that fully irreducibles give me train track maps. So we already had one way of visualizing . So I gave you some kind of automorphism, so I'm going to give you phi. So maybe I should give these, so my fully irreducible phi will give you a train track map G. So down here, I have something that's going to give me the induced map of fundamental groups. So I have, maybe I'm going to send x1 to x2 and x2 to x3 and then x3. Maybe I want to send this to x2, x1, or something of this form. Maybe I'll take that out to make my picture easier. This already would actually be a train track map because I don't want my picture to get too messy. But so we're going to call these x1, and then I'm going to want to be able to send x1, x2. So I'm going to go like this. And again, so I said this picture would come back to haunt you. So here it goes. It's going to haunt you. X1 goes to X2. X2 goes to X3. And then X3 goes over X2 and then X... No, it doesn't. It goes over X1 and then X2. All for simplicity of picture. Okay, so we can always do this. The problem is if I made this more complicated in a way I don't want to draw the picture for, and I wanted to apply my map again and again and again to the interior of an edge, I could end up with cancellation or backtracking. And this makes doing dynamics difficult. You have troubles understanding things like laminations. So instead, we choose another graph. Or they give us a way to find another graph where this is going to be our G. Okay, so this is going to be another homotopy equivalence. And I want to get the same, I want for the picture to work out nicely. Okay, but I want additional things going on. So again, these are homotopy equivalences. These are just markings. What I'm going to require, so I'm still going to get the correct induced map of fundamental groups. Okay, so G star is going to equal phi. But I also want to have that the most important thing is that if I restrict to the interior of an edge, when even after taking a lot of powers, that this is going to be locally injective. For all edges, let's call this gamma, E, for all edges E and gamma, and powers k greater than 0. Okay, so this is going to be our nice way of looking at what these are, and these always exist for fully irreducibles. So I said that you should picture the Igo-Wehe graphs and index lists in terms of foliations, because I'm not going to define them for you here. So I'm not, but I'm going to tell you very briefly what I do. So if I want to get Igo-Wehe graphs in this setting, so instead of reading them off of foliation, I'm going to use this isn't an ideal setting because I'm drastically oversimplifying it. And I do realize I wrote ideal twice. Okay. What we're going to do is we're going to view them in here. And how we're going to do that is we're going to take, so before, what were they doing? They were recording the behavior of the laminations at the singularities. So I want to get a lamination here. How did I get the lamination before? Mm-hmm. I took a simple closed curve or a Sini curve and I applied my pseudonosov again and again and again. I'm going to do the same thing here. I'm going to take a loop in here and I'm going to apply my my fully irreducible again and again and again. And I'm going to get the lamination. So as we iterate loops, so this is step one. So iterating loops gives us again, it's going to give the lamination. And I again want to record what it does at the singularities. Here, by a singularity, you can just think of vertex. Okay, and so what I want to understand is how it enters and so how it enters and leaves the vertices. Okay, so I'm going to record. So for example, here, there are kind of three edges coming out of here. So I would record, these would be vertices, and then I would record how it entered and left, and then I'd leave out certain data. Okay, so I want to. Oh, sorry, what did you say?
You got lamination of what?
Oh, so the lamination is going to be a collection of infinite paths in here that you would get by, for example, just iterating an edge again and again. That would give you something dead, so you'd have to take the closure. But you could think of these as lines in here. You could think of them as lines or in the universal cover, in the free group, in the tracking tree at infinity. So this, so we're going to kind of record how we enter and leave the vertices, except I'm actually going to restrict to the stable directions. So you take a high enough power so that this is fixed. Well, I'm just going to restrict to the directions where, so if this little piece of this edge gets mapped over this little piece of this edge, once I take a high enough power, I'm going to consider that to be stable. Okay, and we want to do that so that this is invariant under taking powers and so on. In fact, that it's so that it's an outer automorphism invariant. So I'm going to restrict to the stable directions. Okay, so that's my ideal way head graph. So again, we want to get from a fully irreducible, we want to get to geodesics. So what we do now is we go from our train track maps to geodesics. And for those who these words mean more to, then I'm going to say that we are going to gradually do a Stallings fold decomposition and then do it again and again and again and again and again to get the infinite geodesic. I'm going to very hand-wavingly to you explain what I mean by that.
So this is geodesics
in outer space.
What metric are you using?
So we're using the analog, so the asymmetric Lipschitz metric. And so what you're going to do is you're going to look over all of the, so I have 2 points. I'm going to look over change of marking maps, and then I'm going to look at what the log of the inf of the Lipschitz constants of all change of marking maps between those.
It is geodesic in one direction, but not in the other.
Exactly, it's asymmetric. So these are asymmetric geodesics also. We like to make our lives difficult for ourselves. But it makes, with that metric, it's a geodesic space, and there's always a geodesic between, from any point to any other point, which is one of the justifications for looking at it. If you try to symmetrize, you lose that.
The ones you're drawing are period.
What I'm drawing here is periodic, right? So there are other geodesics, but I don't care about them, at least for the moment. I didn't talk about them much in the other setting either. Okay, so we're gonna imagine, so I made it blue before. So I have this G is this train track map here. And what I'm gonna do is I'm gonna identify, oh, I told myself when I do this here, I was gonna do this in a way that made these clear. Okay, I'm going to look at this map, and I'm going to look at, oh, these two, so the beginning of this edge and all of this edge go to the same place. So I'm going to glue them together. And as I glue them together, I'm going to pass through a simplex where I have right, this is in the middle of my gluing. I'm going to pass through a simplex where I have this graph instead. I'm going to land here again. Now I'm going to look at a new map like this. I have a new homotopy equivalence after I do this. And I'm going to play the same game. I'm going to say, this edge and this edge, these go to the same place, or this partial edge, these go to the same place. So I'm going to start to glue them. And I'm going to gradually glue them. And as I gradually glue them, I end up over here. Right? And then I do the same thing again. Right? So I keep on doing that. I keep on gluing. And in the end, I end up with a homeomorphism that I know I'm done. So that's really what a Stallings fold decomposition is. Okay? So I'm going to do that again and again and again. And that's how I'm going to move through outer space. Now, in the other circumstance, I gave you one pseudo-Nosov and I got one geodesic by expanding and contracting the foliation. So there were two things that went on here. The first one is that I told you there exists a train track map. Generally, there exists many. Okay. The other piece is that once I have a train track map, if you think about what this procedure does, right, I'm identifying things whose image go to the same place. Well, there could be multiple who do, so there are choices. Okay. So I could generally get a lot of geodesics for the same fully irreducible. And that's the first thing that we want to control if we want some kind of analog of the principal stratum. So
the geodesic is stable under G.
The entire, so if you take under, yeah, exactly. That should do something funny. No, that should also, it should be stable under.
The entire cyclic group actually has an
integer. Yeah. It should also be stable under that.
It acts by translation. But G inverse has a different translation.
Right, so G inverse would have a different axis, would give you a different geodesic kind of oriented in the other way. However, but G inverse does actually.
It's not going to be a geodesic. So,
Right.
What I want to say is that, if you think about it, this is a line, which is a map from R into here, G will act on this line in outer space by translation. That's why it will be with invariant. You can apply G poles backwards and forwards if you like.
So G inverse still stabilizes this thing.
It still stabilizes it, but the geodesic that you get from G inverse is a different geodesic, and that's the part that's annoying. Okay. Because it has to be in the different direction. And Ilya and I both, I think, separately played. No, I don't know that you used this. I used this in my normalizer centralizers paper. Okay, so that fits the cyclic group. It acts by translation and anyway. Okay, so what the ideal way head graph tells us about geodesics. So the first thing, so this is a theorem from a while back. So I never know whether then to include Lee in the. So this is a joint theorem of mine with Lee Mosier from a while back. And we were able to isolate. So you should think of A geometric as generic. It also, they don't come from surface homeomorphisms, but there's even more to them. So in this case, we can say exactly when you have a single axis, and this is going to rely on it's actually going to rely on the Ido-Weihe graph. So I'm going to write the index sum here. I'm going to sum up the indices. I'm going to say it's 3/2 minus R. So if I'd done that in the pseudo-Nosov case, that would have been stupid. It would have been the Euler characteristic. Here it's allowed to vary. But I didn't tell you what the index was at all in this circumstance. You can still get it from the Ido-Weihe graph. It doesn't go the other way around. Okay, you can have a lot of different ideal way-ahead graphs for the same index list. Here you can just read it off 1 minus k over 2, where k is the number of vertices of your component. Okay, so one thing I want to restrict this. The other thing I want to restrict, and I should say actually what this restricts is the number of Stallings fold decompositions that you would get for a single train track map. The other thing is that no component of the ideal way-ahead graph has a cut vertex. And you can think of this as restricting the number of train track maps that you get. So this is when we get a single axis. And this is going to be very important in generalizing the idea of a principal stratum and hoping it's open and proving things about it. So that would be the first theorem that I wanted to say. So the second one. This is a phi. Oh, so it's always between 0 and the Euler characteristic of the graph.
So this is the smallest possible number, right?
So it's the one that's closest to the geometric situation without being in the geometric situation, basically.
I mean, the ones which come from to the also support. After surfaces, they have an even smaller.
Right.
Well, this is the next one, the next smallest.
Yeah, Mark.
Sorry, Catherine, what's Fi in this theorem?
Fully irreducible.
Fully irreducible.
Right, I should have written IWIP for the Europeans. Okay, so theorem.
Yeah,
it's the same as EWIP, as the French would say. Okay, so AKP. Okay, so I would say that this is our generalization of the principal stratum open condition. So we have suppose that phi is an outer automorphism, it's ageometric, fully irreducible, where the ideal way-ahead graph consists of as many triangles as you can make it consist of. And I'll say in particular it falls into the lone axis setting. Okay, and all the ideal way-ahead graph components are triangles. Then there exists our epsilon greater than 0, so that, and I can tell you in a moment what's going on here, so I'm going to say modulo singularity merging pathologies. So as long as you're not in that setting, then for everything in this open set, you're going to get the same ideal way-ahead graph. So for any psi whose axis, I want to say an axis, because I haven't yet distinguished there's only one, but it turns out it's going to be, because it's going to be so it's going to be in the principal stratum. Okay, so the picture here. So this would be the neighborhood of this axis. So I'll draw the picture and I'll tell you. Picture will make it all clear, or not. So I have a lone axis, fully irreducible. So here's this. And now I'm looking at some axis of psi. So here's this axis. I'm going to draw it like this. And what I mean by it being contained in a neighborhood is that, so here's this r and this epsilon, is that these are going to stay for length, oops, so this has to be, the length that they stay close to each other has to be greater than or equal to r, and they are going to stay epsilon close to each other for that length of time. Okay? So if they stay close enough, long enough, it's in the principal stratum. Okay? So the next thing, before I tell you what in the world I mean by pathologies, yeah.
So the green one is the axis of phi, right?
So the yellow one is the axis of phi.
So, but it is axis of phi.
Yeah.
So what is the red one?
It is. So it comes from psi,
okay.
But we don't, until we know this theorem, we don't know it has only one axis. So I'm not going to say the axis of psi, but it is a axis of psi. Then it turns out it's the axis of psi. Okay, so the next thing I want to say, and without saying at all what I mean by that, and then I'll wave my hands at what I mean by all this. So I would say C pathologies exist. Okay. So what are pathologies? So as we talked about, as we went along in the Pseudo-Nosov case, as we went along the geodesic, what are we doing? We're expanding and contracting. And so the foliation doesn't change. So your index, your singularity structure doesn't change. So you never end up merging singularities. They never end up getting glued. Okay. In our circumstance, it actually can happen that I'm going along my geodesic. Oh, it looks like I'm nice in the principal stratum. And then all of a sudden, I glued two together. Now what I can say is, we've shown this happens. We've also shown this is the worst that happens. Okay. So this is true up to the fact that I might have glued some singularities. Controlling to how often, to what extent we end up gluing singularities, that's something we're still trying to figure out. But we can say this, and then I want to add in, though. So this, what I would say, is probably the real principal stratum, but we have a more complicated structure going on, which is analogous, actually, to the more complicated structure that goes on in the Pseudo-Nosov setting, which is that if we look in lower skeleta, we have analogs. We have also kind of stable strata in the lower skeleta. And so anything that's a fully irreducible, sorry, that's a lone axis fully irreducible, where each component is a complete graph, is going to have the same behavior within its own piece of outer space. Okay? So I kind of want to say that here. Which is that, so further, we have a similar picture. For any A phi where this is lone axis plus complete ideal-Whitehead graph components. So we kind of have a finer division of what's going on. So I would summarize all of this as saying, this is where we currently stand in an order of having an analog of the principal stratum, which is that lone axis plus complete Ido-Whitehead graph components say particularly triangles okay so this is probably more or less the principal stratum it's an open condition modulo the pathologies Unfortunately, or maybe fortunately, because maybe it'll make life interesting. Pathologies exist. I'm done.
Okay, are there any questions for Catherine?
Yeah.
So this further, the similar picture for any, you said when the components of the ideal Weigel graph are all complete graphs.
Mm-hmm.
They don't have to be triangles. They could be like K5.
Yeah.
Right? So these are like other strata.
Yeah, they're other strata. But what if you could imagine there would be some kind of skeleton of outer space that within there that those live in. So you figure out which skeleton they live in. Okay, and again, you're going to kind of want to avoid colliding singularities, but anything in there, in that skeleton, you have the same picture where they're open with it, you know.
Okay.
Any other geodesic, any other periodic geodesic that's in that skeleton that stays close enough, long enough, is in the same stratum, as long as you don't hit singularities, right, or singularity
but
collision.
I should say that a really interesting question, which we're not yet close to understanding, is what happens with random fully reducibles which you get by random walks.
Mm.
You know, what their ideal Weigel graphs look like. You know, so.
Mm.
And it's quite possible that, unlike in the surface setting, that here you get several possibilities which probably spoils the probability of each
right.
distinct. So
which is one of the things where I talk about the other strata, is that it's quite possible that there's some kind of interplay going on that, like, maybe they all happen with equal probability or something like this.
Right.
So we're still trying to get a hold on that. But Vaibhav Gadre and Joseph Maher proved, they used the openness of the principal stratum to prove that you generically land in the principal stratum for the mapping class group setting in two different ways. One being, if I go out and stop after some period of time, as I keep on doing that further and further out, I generically end up with a pseudo-Nosov whose foliations are in the principal stratum. And as you go out to infinity, you generically get this, although there's some... there's something that goes on with the fact that you at infinity, these are whitehead classes of measured foliations. And so maybe not in the most satisfying way do you get land in the principal stratum.
If you have more than one geodesic,
mm-hmm.
you always get infinite measurement.
Yeah. Yeah. Wait. Yes. Yes. If you have more than one, you have infinitely many, because you could kind of combine your Stalling Scroll decompositions.
You also can find many periodic ones, but if you look at non-periodic,
right, because you can like simultaneously fold different amounts. Yeah. Yeah.
All right. So if there are no further questions, let's thank Catherine again.